Culture show since the death of our friend and colleague Aidan McGill. I have known Aidan for over 40 years as a friend, a fellow traveller on the musical road, and a colleague at the Western Education Library Board, where we shared an office for a while. We feel his loss very keenly in the quintet, and never a rehearsal goes by without a McGill yarn being told, and laughter rules as it so often did when you're in Aidan's company. Our feelings of loss, of course, pale into insignificance compared to the feeling of loss experienced by Patricia, Sarah, Lauren, Robin and Noah. Rest in peace, Aidan, and know that we miss you every single day.
I can only imagine the amount of work that would have been done with you boys in an office together. Aidan's very much in our thoughts all the time, but especially today as well. We're going to continue now with a lovely song called Can't Take My Eyes Off You. You're just too good to be true. Can't take my eyes off you. You'd be like heaven to touch. I want to hold you so much. At long last, love has arrived, and I thank God I'm alive. You're just too good to be true. Take my eyes off you. just too good to be true. Can't take my eyes off you. Thank you so much. That's lovely and fantastic to be back on the Culture Show, and a beautiful day for our recording here. We're going to keep the music going now with a Michael Jackson number called Rock You. Annette Kelly and have a chat with her.
I am so delighted to have Annette Kelly here with me today. Annette is an absolute ball of energy. You're welcome.
Thank you so much for having me.
We met in Sacred Heart Taddy Ray Primary School. Mm-hmm. How many years ago?
Probably about 4 years ago. Actually 4 years ago to this date. We were putting on Annie in the Struel Arts right here.
That is unbelievable. And since then, your life has just gone a different path.
It has.
When I met you first, the little calendars had just been printed.
That's right.
And you were so excited. So the little penny thoughts.
That's
now,
right.
How did that begin online?
So it began online as a Facebook page. So basically, it was 2015, September time, I was still teaching. And I noticed that the online world was a wee bit negative, and I wanted to add a wee bit of positivity to the online world, so I decided to post uplifting quotes to a page, but I didn't know what the page was going to be called. So I was with my sister one night and we were in her house and I says, I want to start this page online. And you know, this is the importance of having people around you that don't knock you.
Mm-hmm.
She supported me and says, what are you going to call it? I says, I don't know. And her purse was there, and on her purse was scribed a penny for your thoughts.
Yep.
And I was like, penny thoughts. And she said, Annette, throw the word little into it. And then Little Penny Thoughts was born. She created a logo. But it didn't become a limited company until about maybe 4 years, or three, sorry, 3 years ago, 3 to 4 years ago. When I started in 2015, it was just a hobby and I didn't think it would take me in the direction it has.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't realise the quotes would be shared
as much
far and wide mm-hmm. across the world. And then that led me into the path of personal development coaching. Which I now practice in. So even though I've left the route of teaching in the classroom, I feel as if I'm teaching in another direction now, and I love what I do.
Yeah. Well, I mean, there was no doubt that you were always going to be involved with people, and, you know, regardless of the age.
Yes.
But I have to say, I, of course, have one of your calendars.
Yes.
And I see them in so many places. Do you know where I notice them a lot? Is in shops.
Yes.
And not only shops in Tyrone. You know, if you're away in Fermanagh yes. or Donegal, and just sitting up on the counter.
Yes.
And I do have to say, and I know it sounds weird because it is, you use it every day of the
yes.
year and then you get back to the same page yes. again. But very often, and I turn it every single morning,
yeah.
it's in the kitchen, and I turn it, and very often it's what I need, just a kind of, like a wee lift of what I need
to hear. A wee reminder. I've been told it's the book that speaks to you.
Yeah.
And when you go to your date of birth, a lot of people say, that's so me.
Well, I try not to check that because I'll not yes. remember it from the year before.
Yes.
But it is. And OMA Music Academy, of course, Claire Gallagher, you know, great supporter of yours as well. So
wonderful,
have to say, I check that we're on the right date.
Yes.
You know, well, girls are very busy on reception.
Hmm? You're doing your homework every day.
I am. I'm working for you.
Absolutely.
So the Little Penny Thoughts calendar developed, and then you've gone into wellness from within.
Yes.
That's your passion now.
That's my other baby. I have two babies, Little Penny Thoughts, with my sister Orla.
Mm-hmm.
She came along with me on this journey, and then me, myself, and I is wellness
all
from within.
All three of you.
I've got all three personalities. You don't know who you're going to get in any given day, and I would tour the country doing like wee cafe series. I love finding a nice wee cosy nook and doing a workshop on mindset. So I would focus on confidence, resilience, and just a more positive mindset, because I know what it's like to naturally go to the negative.
Yeah.
So I try and claw for the positive and the good in each day.
Yeah.
Now, not every day will be good, but there is good within your day, and it's about hunting the good.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I have to do, because my natural button is to be negative, believe it or not. And people, that shocks people.
Yeah.
But I would naturally think the worst, I would naturally worry. But whereas now I've shifted my mindset to try and see the good and to rationalise my thought process. And that came through me going through counselling myself, CBT, cognitive behaviour therapy, changed my life.
And at what stage did you become aware of that?
Probably very, very early on in my 20s. I noticed I was feeling a wee bit low. When I came back from Australia, I thought I had to have my life sorted.
Mm-hmm.
And have to have the permanent job, the car, the partner, you know, the perfect figure.
You're talking about the pressures of social media.
Pressures of social media mm-hmm. and life, and just people in the comparison trap.
Well, are you going out with anyone
that's
now? Which people do ask, not trying to pry, and I don't honestly feel that they're trying to pigeonhole you. But it's just, it has been such a natural progression for so long. Now things are changing
for the young people
and the teenagers now.
Yeah, but there was definitely societal pressure I would have felt in my mid-20s, and that's when I started this journey of self-loathing.
Aww.
Like I really did. There was a stage where I hated myself, and it was so bad because I had great friends, great family, a great job. It just didn't make sense, and I didn't think that, you know, I would have fallen under the category of someone who would feel anxious and then depressed, because I had nothing to be anxious or depressed about. It was all self-inflicted, but it was only actually going through, you know, going to your GP and, you know, him, he was this amazing doctor, Hearn and Kieran Moore, him just saying, you know, it can happen to anybody.
Yeah.
Nobody's exempt.
There doesn't have to be a reason.
And I never heard of CBT before, and CBT definitely changed my life. I found the right counsellor for me. She'd helped me with thought challenging. So now I catch them negative thoughts, I challenge them and I change them.
Yeah.
Doesn't mean it stops the bad thoughts from coming, but I'm able to react more to them in a healthier way and I don't catastrophize as much.
But Annette, I am familiar with CBT and I'm familiar with lots of people who have gone through this and who are going through this as well. I think your mind has to be at a certain place to be able to accept that as well, because if you're still in that self-loathing, negative state, anything anyone says is, that's rubbish. No. You don't know.
That's it.
You don't experience that's what I've experienced. Whereas actually, everyone's journey is their own, but that feeling of lowness and depression and negativity is the common ground between young people, teenagers, 20s, 30s, and much older. So do you think you really have to be in a place that you're ready to accept the help?
I think you have to want the help. And it takes you to hit rock bottom to realise, you know, the only way is up here, even though you don't think like that.
Yeah.
I was going to sing that song.
The only way is up.
We'll not go there, it's not funny. But anyway. But honestly, it takes and be like, I know I don't want to live like this. I don't want to suffer anymore. I don't want my parents to suffer anymore, because I was affecting my family, but I wasn't able to see that because I was just in my own wee dark hole. And it's actually me accepting that I needed help and that I deserved help was the game changer, that Annette was worthy of happiness.
I think that's the most difficult message to get through to people who deserve.
And it's not about needing help. It's not say that, no, you need help. It's not you need it, you deserve help. Everybody deserves help. And I think for me, that was the game changer when I said, no, I decided to take control of this. Now I have been back to CBT numerous times because it's not a one size quick fix. It takes work, it takes effort, and it takes, as I say, that thought challenging. But when you decide that, you know, you want to improve your quality of life for you,
you
know, not for anybody else, for you, to better yourself as a person, to be kinder to yourself. And that was the root cause of my illness. And I say illness because it is. And it's the most painful thing I've ever experienced in my life, and so many people.
I'm not worthy. That's the message that is constantly in your head. I am not worthy of friendships. I am not worthy of being good to myself, or I'm not worthy of that compliment.
Or even, you know, my biggest, and I was a bit of a perfectionist when I was teaching, especially in the early days. I never thought I was good enough.
Yeah.
And I thought I was failing the children, even though they were in a happy, thriving, secure environment. I felt judged by the parents, felt judged by staff, but it was all just perception and not all thoughts are facts.
Yeah.
So if I was to step back into the classroom now, I would be more confident in my own abilities.
Yeah.
I know I work hard, I care about the children, and that's all that matters.
Do you think you will go back to teaching?
I think so. I think there's still definitely that love and passion for teaching still in me, but I'm enjoying this journey at the minute.
Brilliant.
But teaching was my first choice in terms of either nursing or teaching. So, but I like blending the two at the minute, the caring profession and the education side. And I think this is where I'm most maybe useful in society, is actually sharing this message of, you know, thought challenging and confidence building. And just, you know, just really instilling skills of resilience within the youth.
I think probably with your training as a teacher and just your own natural personality as well, you're drawing on people's creativity. Because if you can express yourself, be it through words or art or acting or dancing, if you can express yourself and get rid of those really negative emotions, just get them out
like
of there.
Drama and theatre is that's my solace. That's where I thrive and I love it. Mm-hmm. Whether it's directing, whether it's been part of shows, that's definitely. And now as I'm getting older, I realise, you know, don't lose that passion.
Yeah.
You know, because work can consume you, and when you're self-employed, you can work all the time. but now I'm trying to strike the balance of work and play.
Yes. You know. I think in your calendar, is it Robin Williams who said something about...
Oh, yes.
I'm not going to be able to
quote.
Spark of madness. Yes. I love that.
You mustn't lose it.
Yeah,
we
I love
get that.
That
small spark of madness.
Yeah.
And I am mad as a brush. Like.
Yeah. Oh, I know. And I love that. And my children say to me, Mama, you're so weird. And I say, good.
I'm weird. Good.
I want to be weird.
Good.
I don't want to be just... I just want to be me.
I, do you know what I mean? There's weirdness in all of us.
Yeah.
We're just letting it out.
It's brilliant.
I love that when, you know, you meet someone for the first time and like we met each other and we just embraced our weirdness.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I love to see you coming through the door.
But you made me feel so, you brightened up my day when I was in there. Honestly, I'm not just saying that because she really does.
Well, the feeling's definitely mutual. Well,
there was something that we recognised in each other.
That's it.
And then, of course, the Annie and all that gorgeous wee girl who played Annie.
All
the kids were fantastic.
They were all brilliant. Just honestly, I have such fond memories of that. And that was a big undertaking.
Mm-hmm.
But I loved it and I relished it because
yeah.
the children, it was all about the Wayans. And
yeah.
that's something Jarlath always instilled
yeah.
as principal, you know.
And still does.
First eyes.
Still does.
He's a legend.
Yeah.
But yeah, so it's been a great journey. And it's lovely to reminisce, you know, how far maybe I've come over this past four to 5 years, especially, most particularly in this past 3 years, and everyone's been through their challenges in life.
Yeah.
But
pandemic and everything.
That's it. Mm-hmm. But I just want to be hope for people,
yeah.
you know,
yeah.
because, you know, when I don't want any sympathy or anything like that, but I know how hard it is to suffer at the hands of your own mental health. And if I can use my platform and use my voice
yes.
to help support and to say, do you know what, you're not alone.
Yeah.
You're not alone and this is very normal.
Yes.
But you're made feel it's abnormal
yes.
and the worst thing someone can say to you is, what's wrong? What's wrong? So what would you
I know. What have you got to be down about?
And you see, the thing is, you
yeah.
can't really detect. You know, especially, you know, it wasn't a trauma that would have led me down this path. It was actually... the inner critic.
Yes.
Have I told you about my inner critic?
Not sure.
So my inner critic, you know, I would, you know, she used to be a permanent resident. I've actually named her.
Okay, what's her name?
I apologise. It's not your name, don't worry. But
thank
it's
God.
Not, it's not very different to your name. I apologise if you know anyone. I don't know anyone with this name, so therefore...
It doesn't matter. You're
Geraldine.
Geraldine, okay.
So Geraldine would be this wee inner voice in my head, mm-hmm. you know, telling me, you know, all the things you don't like about... yourself, or even, you know, would like to highlight my flaws, and I would have listened to Geraldine.
Yeah.
You know, I would have definitely taken her on board, but now I've evicted her. You know,
brilliant.
She didn't pay rent up here in the
yeah.
most precious space I own. She left a wild mess. She was a squatter.
Mm-hmm.
So she had to get to France. Now, she...
Poor
would,
France.
I get to France, I know, poor France, like. But she would come knocking sometimes, and the odd day would let her in. But not today. Even coming up, driving here today, and I get this when I'm recording podcasts or doing speeches, this self-doubt wave of fear comes over me and I sometimes don't feel good enough, and then I just catch the thought, challenge it and change it. And I know it's a wee bit of a bit of banter, you know, calling it journaling, but I actually don't want that voice in my head.
Yeah.
So that's why personifying it
yeah.
helps me.
But you recognise it.
Mm.
And that's the way that you deal with it, and that's how you can deal with that personality, that voice, Geraldine, and put her away. And it's whatever works for you.
Whatever works for you, and
yeah.
there's no rules here.
Yeah.
You just have to try and, you know, get through it. But I really want to beat that inner critic, and I feel so many people are their own worst critic.
Oh, totally.
Like
totally.
I was at a wedding the other day, and so many women were, especially women, because that's women talk more about... how much they hate themselves and their bodies. And I was just like, you're looking so beautiful. And they're like, why is it up? I have put on so much. I was like, oh my God, isn't it great to be fit to eat? Isn't it great
mm-hmm.
to fit? And you look so well and
mm-hmm.
things like that. And but there's no point someone else telling you look well if you can't give yourself a wee bit of...
Yeah.
But it's not about appearance. It's not about... It's about how you feel from the inside out. So that's where wellness from within.
Yes.
The concept of, you know, go into yourself. Become well from the inside out.
It's not those perfect pictures on social media.
Oh, sweet above.
Which, you
know... They take about... To get my perfect picture on social media, you know, it's about 10 to 20 pictures, you know, that you have to wade through to see which one you like the best. You poke flaws in all of them and you realise, mm-hmm. Get yourself on in it.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, years ago, disposable camera.
I know.
We didn't have a chance to go through
the negatives. I read something the other day and I thought it was really funny. Someone put up as a memory. Do you remember the days when you used to go out for a meal and you take your wee disposable camera with you, you take a photograph of your food, send it away, get it developed, and then go around everyone's houses and show them the meal that you had when you were out? And I was like, no, because we didn't do it.
We lived in the moment years ago. We're living in everybody's moment.
Yeah, well, we want... A lot of people want everyone to experience their moment.
Mm.
But I think the other thing, I have so much I want to talk to you about, but I think the other thing is everything is so immediate now.
Instant gratification.
You know, and it's, there's no quiet and there's no accepting. Sure, isn't that lovely? Is it not perfect? That's grand. Mm. That's lovely. Mm. What do you think then of the people who were never diagnosed either by themselves or with a very helpful doctor, you know, before we became so aware of the importance of mental health and how prevalent it is in all of us in some state or form. You know, how so many advances have been made now, which is brilliant.
Definitely. I do think that a lot of people in the past have slipped through the net, you know, and to look at how, you know, people were treated. You know, with a mental health problem, they were jailed. Yeah. It was basically like jail.
And or hidden and locked
hidden
away.
And locked away because they're mad.
Yeah.
You know, and at the end of the day, that wasn't going to help their recovery.
And if you think then also about hereditary traits, that went all through the family. You know, I do think of people that, you know, friends of my mum and dad and friends of aunts and uncles and all that sort of thing. And I think, now I know why they reacted the way they, or now I know why that personality was, you know, very hidden and not sociable.
See, you just the think fear of judgment, you know, fear of people thinking, oh, you know, it's taboo and things like that, stigma. But, you know, a lot of other people would, people would call, you know, depression, anxiety, the sadness.
Okay.
Well, did you get the sadness? Do you know what I mean? Because they're not able, they're not even comfortable with the diagnosis of depression or anxiety. But also I do think the depression, anxiety are words that are thrown about at the minute.
Yeah.
You know, and I don't say that lightly, but I just think that before, you know, you self-diagnose, you know, you get professional support and help because, like, it's just, it's a very, very fine line between health and ill health.
Yes.
But it's recognise it within yourself, but then also getting that, you know, professional opinion.
Yeah.
Well,
with your wellness from within,
yes,
I'm sure you're all over the place. And can people Google it or Facebook?
I just, like, so I'm not a counsellor. I never claimed to be, but I'm trained personal development coach. And I work, you know, in terms of preventative. So, like, the likes of my clients would be people that maybe want to build their confidence or maybe change careers or want to improve their relationships. But the most important relationship that I work on is the relationship they have with themselves.
Absolutely.
Because it's not about their partner.
Yeah.
It's not about their son.
Yeah.
It's about how they're treating themselves.
Yeah.
Themselves.
And, you know, yes, if they're keeping their head above water, that's great. But the rest of the body needs to be well also.
Oh, definitely. And that's why self-care is so important. How are you filling up your cup? What are you doing for yourself?
Well, you're definitely still keeping all that going with this brilliant project you have with the Irish News, Young News Readers Project.
Yes, so that's
first primary school,
link.
Isn't it?
Yes, primary and secondary.
Oh, and I thought it was only primary.
This is my third year being part of the Irish News Young News
Guest Editor.
Project. Guest editor.
Very nice.
So it's exciting to be part of that process, and I'm, you know, visiting schools, and especially now being allowed back in schools is great.
And that's all part of your teacher training as well. You know, everything is just, the momentum's there that you can draw on that.
And there's
training.
A theme every week, you know, and it's all, you know, trying to find positivity within the media and giving children an opportunity to feel a paper.
Yeah.
You know, and it's a very child-friendly version of the paper where they can access, feel the paper, actually turn pages, not swipe.
Yes.
Smell the paper, you know, see the paper, and, like, images and pictures and stories and interviews of, you know, influential people, and it's a really, really great project, and it's in conjunction with St Mary's University College, which I'm a past student of. So it's lovely, and there's, I get involved with lots of projects. Another project I will be involved with through is Darkness Into Light.
Yes.
I've been ambassador this past 4 years.
For the prevention of suicide.
That's it. Yeah. Yes, and it's just so, it's just so important.
Sad, sad road. You know, that if you're not getting the help, and if you're if you're drowning in that depression, unfortunately, very possibly that's where it could
and
end.
I do think there's, you know, strength and unity when people don their yellow t-shirts, and just there's a sea of yellow in all corners of the world.
Yeah.
You know, it's at the start of May.
Yeah.
So I'm involved in different projects, but every project I'm involved with, I'm passionate about.
Yeah. And that comes across.
Yes, I'm very passionate about it, and probably sometimes OTT, but that's just me. I'm all or nothing. Mm-hmm. I'm either interested or not.
Yeah.
But I used to be a big yes woman. Everywhere but the crib, and every committee going. I think it was even in the boxing committee. So what would I know about boxing? But I know about fundraising. I know about getting people together. I don't think it was in the boxing committee. I'm actually only joking. But
I would love to do that.
There was lots of, but there was lots of things that I was involved with because I didn't want to let other people down. Yeah. But what was happening was every time I was saying yes to other people, I was saying no to myself.
Yeah.
Yes to them, and pressure on me. And I just thought, you know what, now I have to think, is it going to bring me peace or pressure?
Okay.
And if it's going to bring me pressure, I have to politely decline, which is hard. Mm-hmm. No is the smallest word in the dictionary, isn't it? Well, one of them.
A.
It's one of them. Okay. Yes.
And I'm not even still, the primary school teacher.
I know. But it's now it's saying no and not going into the spiel of why you can't do something.
Yes.
Because you have to honour your time and your energy. And
you don't have to always explain yourself.
I know, but that's the type of person I am. Mm. And I love helping people. And if I can help someone, I will. And if I can't, I'll make sure I'll point them in the direction of someone who can. And that's something that I love to do. I love connecting with, you know, like-minded people. And, you know, so it's an absolute pleasure to be here today and having the crack.
Well, I'm so relieved that this was going to be, what was it, pressure or pleasure? Was it?
So pressure or peace.
Pressure, oh, right. So
this
coming into the
great
culture.
And pleasure.
Good.
But great peace, because it's just lovely to be asked. And I think this, you know, the culture shows such a fantastic idea.
It is a brilliant idea.
It's very, very, it's very important too for on a local level. You know, to see what's going on.
Yeah. And you know, people who maybe weren't aware of the work that you were doing or hadn't come across you in primary schools.
Well, I'm always keen, you know, to talk about my journey, because people would look at me and I get the nickname Positive Penny and rainbows and butterflies. But behind that, there was a lot of darkness, sadness, and a lot of self-discovery in order to get where I am today. And where I am today is contentment.
That's fantastic.
When people talk about success, the best achievement ever is overcoming depression. I may well again, do you know what I mean? I don't say I've beat it and that's it.
It's an ongoing journey.
Life isn't linear.
Yeah.
As we know, it's up and down roller coaster, but you know, I'm here, I'm strapped in.
We are so delighted that you came on to the Culture Show. I think you may have to come back at some stage.
Absolutely.
There's too much to talk about.
And there's so many songs to sing.
I was just going to say, I'm excited to keep an eye on the Young Newsreaders project as well, and keep an eye on Wellness From Within, and of course the Darkness Into Light.
Yes.
And will there be another edition of the calendar? Or
every year we produce a new diary, and it's called One Day at a Time.
Aww.
So that's a big theme within Little Penny Thoughts. You know, all we can do is take it one day at a time. Life doesn't travel faster than one day at a time. So there'll be newness coming out in that.
Lovely.
We are working on volume 3. I don't think that many people know that, but we were working on volume 3, and we're adding to our range as well. It's very much a family affair. My brother's on board as well.
Brilliant.
And it's going from strength to strength at our pace.
Great.
And I'm glad that the products that we produce are hopefully making a difference into the lives of people all across the world.
I'm sure you and I are nearly related now. We've discovered as well with my nephew and your cousin.
Yes. Sure,
we're sisters.
Bridesmaids.
Of every kind. Well, I'll tell you, Stevie Crooks, who's doing the sound for us and the vision today, Stevie's coping very, very well because he's a new father of 10-week-old Molly.
Congratulations.
Congratulations to Stevie and Wendy.
Class.
Isn't he brilliant to be upright
Fair
for
play.
The baby only to be only to be 10 weeks. Annette, thank you so much for coming on the Culture Show. This song you will love,
okay,
that we're going to continue with now, and it's called Wild Horses.
Absolutely love that song.
Yeah,
and I was whenever we were talking about it before, I was getting it mixed up in my head. I remember saying to Paul, I was getting it mixed up in my head with Crazy Horses, which I think was by the Osmonds. So when I listened to it, I thought, can't imagine the quintet doing that. So hope you enjoyed that. We want to say a special hello to Brendan McCarthy. Brendan has been a big part of the Culture Show, particularly for about the last. The last 6-7 months, really. So, sending him our best wishes. Brendan, look forward to having you back on the Culture Show and you back to full health. We're going to keep the music going now, changing the mood completely with Sweet Georgia Brown.
No gal made has got a shade on Sweet Georgia Brown. Left feet, but also neat hands, Sweet Georgia Brown. with Georgia Brown. I tell you why. You know I don't lie much. It's been said she knocks them dead when she lands in town. When she came, why, it's a shame how she cools them down. Fellas, she can't get hard. Fellas, she ain't met. Georgia named her, Georgia claimed her, sweet Georgia Brown.
Georgia Brown, she did. We have a great Randy Crawford number now. Great choice of music, as always, with the Culture Show. But yes, thank you very much, Paul. Randy Crawford. Who White Horses, that was Rolling Stones, wasn't it? Rolling Stones, yeah. Fantastic.
Flying Burrito Brothers.
Flying Burrito Brothers?
Yeah.
Not even lunchtime.
He's a font of information.
A font.
He knows
yes, he
everything
is.
About everything.
And if he doesn't, he knows how to pretend he does. So this is One Day I'll Fly Away.
Yesterday, one more can.
Over to Andrew Maguire, who's talking to Andy Gordon.
Hello, I'm here with Andy Gordon. Andy is a popular and recognisable figure around Oma in many guises. Initially, he was a teacher at the Oma High School. He later went on to be a job coach at Southwest College, and he is recognised as a columnist with Oma Today and a radio presenter, former radio presenter with Q101. I've known Andy nearly all my life, in fact. I'm used to having conversations with him mainly about football and about Man United, but since that hasn't been much fun the last few years, it'll be nice to ask him a few different questions today as we talk about the role of that a few books have had in his life and that reading has had in his life in general. Andy, it's great to have you here.
I'm good to be here, Andrew. I can remember being at your house for the Eurovision Song Contest. We used to go right here, Mum and Dad, and we'd watch the Eurovision song. We never watched the songs, we watched the voting.
Yeah.
Your dad was a tremendous cook, and mm-hmm. used to make. And I can remember carrying you around the kitchen, and you bawling your eyes out, and we couldn't get you to bed to eat. Joy with that, Andrew.
Well, that's because the abuse is coming a bit quicker than I thought it would, but I knew it would come, but fair enough. And I always start by asking the guests the sort of the role that reading had as they were growing up. I know for you, sport and music were probably the big fascinations and passions. How did reading sort of fit into that?
Well, I suppose my father was an avid reader. He read. He was a member of a book club, and there was books came every month, and he read them. And I suppose I started picking them up at some stage, and then I suppose it whenever I got, whenever round about upper sixth form in school, it sort of accelerated.
Mm-hmm.
I can remember going, funny where we are in the Arts Centre here. The old town hall used to be on this site, only it was pushed right out onto the high street. And you went up the steps, and just as you went through the door, on the left-hand side was a door. And that was our library in Oma in those days in the 1960s. And an old lady, Mrs. Coote, she looked after everything, very strict young.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I started reading there and just went in there every week and took a couple of books out and brought them back and, you know.
And the first book you're going to talk about is Beyond Belief, a book about the Moors murders.
Yes, yes.
How did that?
Well, that was
that true crime genre.
What I took to reading was true crime, true murders, about anything I could get my hands on that was true, and was and ended up in murder. God, that was awful. That was me. And that happened to be, the Moors murders happened in 65, so I was, 16 then. The book came out the early days of 67, just before I moved to Belfast. So I think I actually bought the book, if I can remember right, because I had a copy at home for years and years. And it was just the fascination with listening to the radio and the court case. about these two horrendous people, Myra Hindley and Brady, Ian Brady, who did, and in those days, you didn't get much of that. We'd get that every week, maybe every month, you know, in the news now about murder and mayhem and all. But it was strange that in those days that it was such a big thing, but it was a huge thing.
And you were almost ahead of the game in that sense, because true crime in terms of TV and podcasts and stuff is so popular as a genre now. Is it still something you're interested in? What is the thing that draws you to it?
Not so much now, Andrew. Maybe back then it was, as I say, listening to the court case, and then somebody brought a book out about it. It was one of the first books, you know, about that type of thing. And the guy who wrote it, Emlyn Williams, looking back on it, he got a whole lot of things wrong. But he was one of the first to try it anyway. But no, I haven't. I suppose then I moved to Belfast not long after that, went to college and got married, and I sort of stopped reading that sort of thing. But that's the one that sticks in my mind. I have two or three copies at home.
I think you get that a lot of young people be interested in things like that, and then as they get older and all of a sudden have children and stuff, the morbid thing becomes less
more,
interesting and more maybe scary. Tell us a bit more about that stage of your life, as you say, when you went to Belfast and whatnot, and I know that's when you started getting involved in things like radio, and you were still so heavily involved in sport and stuff. Tell us about that stage of your life in general.
Well, about my sort of later school days. I hated school. I detested school, Andrew. I lived in the early days, you know, I went to the academy, and in the early days I lived in Festival Park. And I used to ride a bicycle down. There's a wee runway you could go behind the houses and down through Johnson Park, and I would ride out to the end of Festival Park to the front. And instead of turning right to go down to the school, quite often I went left and went up the hill. And there used to be an old bunker at the golf club up that road. And I would throw the bike in the hedge and I would spend all day in there reading. and I hated it. I hated it school. And that stopped now. That stopped one day because my father worked for the Ministry of Agriculture. And on a Thursday, he'd been out round farms, and here, dear, didn't he pass my bicycle one day? Saw it, took me down to the headmaster, and that was the last of me turning left.
And I wonder, how did that, your experience with school, how did that translate and affect you then when you went into teaching, and both at the high school and then your role at Southwest College? Did that influence how you treated students?
The headmaster at that stage asked me, what do you want to do yourself, young Gordon? And I said, I want to be a teacher. And he laughed at me, absolutely laughed. But basically what I wanted to do was I wanted to be a PE teacher, because all my PE teacher, Roy Wilson and Bill Haw, you know, I would have died for them. I love PE, and I ended up becoming a PE teacher, but, you know. And then funny, the headmaster, I met him years later at the rugby club, and I came in after a game, and he was standing having his half pint, and he came and he turned around, he said, "Ah, young Gordon," he says, "I see they made a teacher out of you after all. Well done." And you know, the shivers come down my spine even thinking about it now, Andrew, you know. That was lovely, you know. But so I went on, moved to Belfast, and I shouldn't really say anything bad about the academy, but I did my last year because my dad was transferred. I did it in Grosvenor High School up in Castlereagh in Belfast, and it was a real school. and the kids there wanted to learn. There was and this was a totally different environment. So I did my second year. I did A-level art, I think, in Oma, and got it before I left because it started it early. But if I hadn't gone to Grosvenor High School, I would not have got the two A-levels to get me into college.
Yeah.
Absolutely not. You know, I went from having one teacher for geography here and one for English. Up there, I had three for English and three for geography. The pupils wanted to learn, you know, which was... And that helped. That helped, you know.
If we go on to speak a bit about the second book you're going to talk about.
All right, okay.
Valley of the Horses.
Well, the Clan of the Cave Bear. It's a trilogy.
It's a trilogy, yeah.
It's a trilogy. Gene Aul, an American writer. Yeah, I read those in the 70s when I was married. Mm-hmm. Oh, dear. She'll never hear this or see this, I hope. On my honeymoon, I read 6 books on my honeymoon. It was a fortnight in Sardinia, and I read 6 books. Mm-hmm. So I was an avid reader, but I'd moved on. They were just novels and all. But I came across this thing, and she writes about Neanderthal men. You know, mm-hmm. that from, you know, I don't know, many years ago. Look, I've a note here. It's Neanderthals went from 120,000 years ago to 40,000 years ago, right? Mm-hmm. They're the ones with the big broad heads and all. And then the sort of the Cro-Magnons, sort of more European, fair-haired, mm-hmm. appeared from wherever they appeared from. And it's all about that. And those 3 books that follow a girl, Isla, as a child after an earthquake, she's wandering about, and these new people, or these old Neanderthals, found her, took her under their wing, and let her live with them and all. But it moves on past them, follows her past them, you know, and all. And it's just it's a beautiful, they're beautiful books. Mm-hmm. I'll give you the copies and you can read them, Andrew. But you know what it did to me? I was brought up going to church on Sundays and Sunday school and stuff like that. And in the 70s, it sort of copper fastened a wee doubt I had in my mind that's how it all was. It just happened. We mm-hmm. just evolved. I don't think there was a bigger hand mm-hmm. moving us about.
And obviously, I mean, those are the novels, but it sounds like your primary interest in them was the factual elements behind it.
Yes.
And is that something that you've always looked more to in your reading? Is it that non-fiction side of things and that the reality?
I think I moved from that. I moved on to and looked for things that really, you know, yes, mm-hmm. I think you're right there.
And then that sort of leads on. I mean, the third book you're going to speak about is And Away by Bob Mortimer, who so many people will be aware of as, you know, the comedian, but maybe haven't read the book. What is it that drew you to that?
I did Mortimer and Reeves, I don't know, many years ago that mm-hmm. was. I never watched them.
Yeah.
And it's only recently, I think through Would I Lie to You?
Yes.
where Bob Mortimer appears. And it just, he's such a funny man. And I started sort of, you know, looking out for, and then this book came out and Evelyn mm-hmm. bought it for Christmas for me. And also at the same time, I bought an audio copy of it. Mm-hmm. So I have it on the Kindle and I keep switching about. And I find him fascinating, he's 10 years younger than I am. Mm-hmm. He was brought up in a very working class environment, brought up by his mother. I would say that I was probably brought up here middle class. Mm-hmm. Father and mother were always there. And as we were talking earlier about, I went home from, I was at school, I went home for dinner, walked home, had my dinner, my mother had the dinner out.
Yeah.
Went on to college, went home in the evening, my mother had my dinner for me there. Got a job down in Oma, got married. I went home from work, and my wife and my dinner there. So I've never learned to cook.
Yeah.
It's always been there. So and Bob, you know, moved out of his home and he moved in with some mates and friends. Mm-hmm. But he was also very lonely at times. And you introduced me as a very popular, or something, I don't know what it was, but I can be very lonely. Mm-hmm. I can be very, especially over the last few years, I can find myself, I think maybe COVID has done this to a lot of people, where you've been in your house for the, you know, for a whole year, not getting out much, and it suited me. Mm-hmm. I quite enjoyed it, you know. So I can see, but this is another thing about Bob Mort. Could I just read it?
Yes, please.
Just
do,
read
yeah.
it. This was another thing that attracted me to him. He had a heart problem, and I 2 years ago had a heart problem, and this is where he said he had spoken to his surgeon and he gave me an idiot's guide to what he did to him. You see, mm-hmm. and this was it. He says, firstly, a 2-foot incision was made in my left leg from my knee to ankle. An artery was removed for use as a bypass routing material. Then, using an electric saw, my sternum, my breastbone, was cut down the middle. A huge clamp was then placed either side of the sternum to open up the chest cavity. I was then placed on a ventilator and my lungs deflated to aid access to my heart. And then the heart was pulled out of the chest and rest above the cavity, where it was injected with potassium, which shut it down completely. It would have been impossible to operate on a bouncing heart after all. So the machine does the job.
And are you... and was that something you were able to read? And what...
Absolutely.
Does that, how does that affect you?
I had heart problems a couple of years ago and had the operation, a different operation than that. I didn't have the artery. I had an aneurysm on my aorta, so I didn't have bypass. They just had to change. It's plumbing. They put a bit of plastic in. So what he did, the chest bone being put and that pulled back, that all happened to me. Mm-hmm. And it's just weird reading it after this time. You know,
And the three books you've mentioned there, it sounds like is reading and books, is it something you turn to when to almost discover more about something you're interested in? I mean, that seems to be the theme. That
yes,
from what
and
you
funny,
do.
The week before my operation, it was on BBC One, a program called Operations. I was in for a couple of weeks beforehand, and this nurse and I watched my operation a week before it happened to me. And it was amazing to see that and to hear Bob Mortimer come out with that and to have gone through the same sort of thing. And he puts it so well.
Yeah.
You know, I couldn't have described that as well.
As we sort of wrap up, I need to ask you about, I mean, as I mentioned at the start, I think, you know, radio has been one of the most things you've been most passionate about. And sort of in terms of even the books you've described, you know, it's about real stories and real things. And I think that's a lot of your video was about that as well, and interacting with people and real stories. So, I mean, when you look back in your time with radio and local radio around Doma, what's your sort of the fondest memories you have?
I'm a radio person. I could do without television. But I could not do without radio. The first thing I do in the car is the radio's on at RTE or Radio Ulster or wherever it is, Radio 4. I'm a radio... And I love radio, and I love both sides of it. I love doing Strule FM, you know, with your dad and everybody who was involved with that. We had great fun those 2 years doing Strule FM from here. I was at college. Well, in fact, you live opposite the hospital, Andrew. They're tearing it down at the minute. Mm-hmm. I can pass the other day, and the building on the left-hand side was a nurse's home. And the roof was off it, and I thought, that's where I started. Hospital radio in Oma in 1979 was the first time in Oma. But before that, at college, we had a wee radio station, Radio 5, and I played music in it. So that it spreads way back from there. And it's lovely doing it from both sides. Mm-hmm. There's so much out there in radio. There's a great program. Now, you see, you brought me in here to interview me at this time on a Saturday. And Storytellers is in Radio Ulster. I'll have to go home and listen to it. And that's the lovely thing about technology. You can just go back, and if you don't miss anything now. You just go back and look for it, you know.
Brilliant. Well, Andy, we've had many great conversations over the years. Thanks very much for coming in and joining me for another one here.
It's been a pleasure.
It's been great having you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks very much.
New York on Sunday, big city taking a nap. Slow down, it's Sunday, life's more than a few. stalls, and in one of those stores is a face next to yours in the glass. Too hot, stop beating. You're both too breathless to speak. Love smiles a greeting, then the dream that has seen you through the way. And in one of those stores is a face next to yours in the glass. Too hot, stop beating. You're both too breathless to speak. Love smiles her greeting. Then the dream that has seen you through the wind comes true on Sunday in New York.
New York, London, Los Angeles, Oman, Carrickmore, for Annette. we're going to have our last song, and then we have a lovely piece of music to remember our lovely Aidan McGill, of course. So we're going to keep it going now with Oye Como Va.
Thank you.
As to what languages were we singing in. So we have come to the end of the first culture show for 2022. Thank you so much for joining us. As Bob mentioned earlier, we're remembering especially our friend and colleague and musician, Aidan McGill. We're also very pleased to welcome one of the finest young bass players on the scene today, Danny McCormick, who's here with us. So Danny, lovely to have you here. And the boys are going to end this culture show with one of Aidan's favourite, Wichita Lions Man. And I'm sure, like the rest of us, you'll be able to hear Aidan sing in your head. Thank you so much. Thank you.